Covenant Church has been rooted in the North Park, San Diego neighborhood for over 70 years. We believe that God is restoring his creation and renewing lives in our church, our neighborhood, our city, and cultures around the world for his glory. My name is Patrick, and I'm the lead pastor here, and I'd personally love to invite you to join us Sunday, 10 a.m. in North Park at the corner of Howard and 30th. Thanks. Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to Covenant. If you're visiting, a special welcome to you. Glad that you're here today. My name is Patrick, and I'm the pastor here. You know, in our call to worship in Hebrews 4, it talks about weaknesses. It talks about burdens. It talks about temptations. But it also talks about Jesus, one who can empathize with all of those things and yet overcome them. And so as we enter into worship today and we read our call to worship, it says in Hebrews 4, we can hold firmly to the faith that we profess, that we don't have to be burdened down by weaknesses or temptations, that we have one who empathized with us and overcome. So would you stand, if you would, as we read our call to worship today from Hebrews 4 and are mindful that we can hold firmly to the hope that we profess. I'll do the leader portion. Please join aloud in the all portion. Peace be with you. Since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. But we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Father, we thank you that as we come into this space and we reflect on our weeks and we reflect on our morning, Lord, if we're honest, we have weaknesses, we have burdens, we have temptations, and yet the good news is that we don't have to hide that from you. We can be open and honest with that because we worship the one who can empathize with our weaknesses, one who became incarnate and was among us, God with us, Emmanuel, and yet you overcame that. So God, thank you that we can hold firmly to the faith that we profess, that we can come to you boldly knowing that you're a God who's gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. So, Lord, calm our hearts. Help us to be present in heart and mind, body and soul, and praise you today. In Christ's name, amen.
Good morning, everyone. Let us approach God's throne of grace with confidence and sing of the greatness of our Lord God Almighty.
Blessed be the Lord God Almighty. was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore, who reigns forevermore, who reigns
sing, turn your ear.
Turn your ear to heaven and hear the noise inside, the sound of angels are the sound of angels' songs, and all this for a join and sing all to Christ the King. How constant, how divine, this song of ours will rise. Oh, how constant, how divine, this love of ours will rise, will rise. And raise a joyous noise, the sound of salvation comes, the sound of rescued ones, and all this for a king. Angels join to sing, all for Christ the King. Love so rescuing, oh how infinitely sweet this great love that has redeemed. As one we sing, Alleluia, Alleluia, He is holy. Holy, He is holy, He is holy, God to thee.
Amen. How great God is. We'll lead into this time for our confession of sin. This is where we confess our sins to God, knowing that He forgives us in Christ. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against You in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved You with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey You in newness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please take a moment to confess your sins privately to God, knowing that God hears us. Let's receive these words of forgiveness and comfort from God. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in Him. God, may we abide in You and have death to our self-sufficiency. When we are tired, weary, and grow faint, may You lift us up and have Your strength shine. Now may we please stand for the reading of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Sing a new song this morning, the greatness and the mercy of God.
Thy mercy, my God, is the theme of my song, the joy of my heart, and the boast of my tongue. Thy free grace alone, from the first to the last, hath won my affections and bound my soul fast. Without Thy sweet mercy, I could not live here. Sin would reduce me to utter despair, but through Thy free goodness my spirit's revived, and He that first made me still keeps me alive. Thy mercy is more than a match for my heart, which wonders to hardness departs. Dissolved by Thy goodness, I fall to the ground and weep for the praise of the mercy I found. Hallelujah. Great Father of mercies, thy goodness I own, and the covenant love of thy crucified Son. All praise to the Spirit, whose whisper divine seals mercy and pardon and righteousness mine. All praise to the Spirit, whose whisper divine seals mercy and pardon and righteousness mine.
God, we thank you that you welcome us into your presence, not based upon our own goodness, our performance this past week, or even throughout our lives, as though we could build up a good enough record to be welcomed by you. But we rely solely on Jesus and his perfect life, his death and resurrection, ascension in our place. What a great mercy that is, for we could not earn it. We don't deserve it. And we thank you that this morning we get to revel in that good news, in the greatness of Jesus and your goodness to us. We thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, it's the kids, elementary and middle school, can be dismissed out to their teachers out in the lobby there. And the rest of you, please just take, I think we have 5 minutes for a greet and to say hi to each other this morning. So go ahead and greet one another. Thanks.
Welcome to Covenant. Ooh. Few quick announcements today, and then we'll get rolling. If we look on our handout, there's two here, one about community groups and our Intro to Covenant class. If you are not plugged into a small group, a community group, a time of connecting with fellow members of the church, people of the church, believers, outside of Sunday morning, please contact Kennerly to get plugged in with that. And then our Intro to Covenant class, which is essentially a Covenant 101, belief statements, introduction, how to become members. Our next meeting is November 6th, right after church. November 6th, right after church. November 6th. Right after church. And we'll also give you updates every Sunday until then, including the day of. But it's a good time. And yeah. All right, now we'll bring up Andy for the reading of today's scripture.
Good morning. My name is Andy Wolf, and I'll be reading scripture for this morning. The passage is John 13, verses 1 through 17. It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave his world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," said Simon Peter, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "Those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean. And you are clean, though not every one of you." For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your teacher and Lord, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Andy and Jake, for leading us in worship and for the musicians. And so we're continuing in our series. We got 2 weeks left of it, just thinking about the purpose of the church and why we exist. We've talked already about the idea of that we're rooted in the gospel. The gospel, the good news of Jesus, is the foundation that all that we do. We've talked about how we are our messengers. We're sent into the world with this gospel message to proclaim it and to live it. We've talked about how we gather each week on Sundays as a community to gather around the gospel, where we sing and we pray and we encourage each other. Last week, we talked about how we grow as disciples, that as we listen and follow Jesus, he transforms us, that none of us stay the same, that Jesus changes us more and more in his image. And today, we come on this idea of blessing our neighborhood and city, that we do gather, but as we disperse, then we are here for the good of our neighbors. And we put it this way, that we seek to give mercy and promote biblical justice for the flourishing of our neighbors. But the question is, how do we be a people of mercy and justice? And the way that you do it is you need the right example to follow. You need the right map to follow, because to be a people of mercy and justice, if you have the wrong map, if you have the wrong example, you can get off course with this. And I think the account of George DeLong and the USS Jeannette kind of captures this truth of following the wrong map or getting off track. So it was 1879, and DeLong and his crew of explorers, they wanted to go and claim the North Pole for the United States. So at this point in history, no one had ever been to the North Pole. It was almost like traveling to an unexplored planet. And so DeLong and his crew wanted to be there first and to claim the North Pole, the top of the world, for the United States. And they were following maps by a famous map maker at the time named August Peterman. And Peterman had this theory that once you got through some ice at the top of the North Pole, there was this open sea. Now, Milton's going to put a map up on the screen. You can see the supposed open polar sea. So this was the working theory at the time, that if you got through initial ice, it was almost like open sea, like the Caribbean, and you would sail on smoothly to the North Pole. It didn't work out that way, huh? So they set out with this assumption, and in September of 1879, they got stuck in an ice pack. And DeLong and his crew and the USS Jeannette stayed in this ice pack for 2 years. And slowly the ice went and it crushed the boat. And tragically, many of the crew survived, though some were able to escape to Siberia. And in this tragic account, it does illustrate the point, though, that if you have the wrong map, if you have a map like this and you think that there is an open sea at the top of the North Pole, you're going to get off course. You're not going to make it where you're going. And I think Jesus, as he says in this passage, I have set an example for you. In a way, I have created a map for you to follow. Just as I have done this, now I want you to follow this example, to follow this map, if you will. And if you do this, this life of metaphorical foot washing, it will bring you life and those around you. It will bring you flourishing and those around you. In a way, we could say this, Jesus on bended knee is the map that leads to life. It's the example that leads to life. So three ideas we're going to talk about. Jesus washed then. We're going to look at the scene where Jesus washed the disciples initially. Jesus washes now. He continues to wash. Then the question to us, who are we washing? So first, Jesus washed then. In the mid-19th century, there was a painter named Ford Madox Brown, and he painted a famous account of Jesus washing Peter's feet. You may have seen this painting before. Put yourself in the room. Put yourself at the meal. There's three verbs of preparation as Jesus washed feet. It says he got up from the meal. The meal's going on, and all of a sudden Jesus rises. He takes off his outer garment. And he wraps a towel around his waist. Imagine what's going on in the disciples' minds. What is Jesus doing? No one expected a foot washing. He rises, his outer garment is off, the towel is around his waist. Three verbs of action. He poured water. He poured. And it says he washed the disciples' feet. He washed. He poured, he washed, and then he dried with a towel. And there's one verb that's implicit that isn't spoken, but it would be understood. Jesus knelt. Jesus got low. Jesus got low to the place where these feet, these filthy feet, these cut-up feet, these smelly feet, these unclean feet, Jesus gets low, and he washes. Now, think about this for a moment. See, in Jesus' culture, so much more than ours, though it is to a degree in ours, but you don't kneel. Adults don't kneel. Free people don't kneel. Aristotle, in fact, called for an adult male to kneel would be barbaric. This is a barbaric act. The disciples would be horrified. Jesus, their teacher, Jesus, their rabbi, Jesus, their leader, is down on bended knee, washing what is filthy and cut up and unclean and smelly. But I don't think we have to kind of imagine that culture. Just think about your life. When is the last time you kneeled before someone? So we don't kneel. And whatever our culture has as norms about kneeling, Jesus's was far more. And yet Jesus breaks this cultural taboo. Jesus gets on bended knee. He washes to show us mercy and to give us a map to be mercy givers. But there's more. There's more here than just a rabbi or a teacher or a leader washing feet. This isn't just a random act of kindness. I want you to see this. To see Jesus is to see God. To see Jesus is to see God. So you have God. You have God kneeling. You have God washing what is unclean. Verse 3. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave the world and go to the Father. See, Jesus and the Father and the Father and the Son and the Son and the Holy Spirit were in perfect relationship for eternity. It's the Christian idea of the Trinity, one God and three persons. And for eternity, they were in perfect relationship. And yet, for 33 short years, Jesus enters in to this world. The Creator becomes part of the creation. And Jesus knows that his time is running short and he's going to go back to be with the Father. But before he does that, in a way like a movie trailer for his whole life, Jesus gets down on bended knee and washes. Now think about that. The all-knowing, the all-present, the all-powerful, the Creator and the Sustainer of all things. That's who God is. That's who we claim he is. That one above all things who reigns forever and ever, that one knelt. It's the God who kneels. I mean, let your imagination just explode with that for a moment if this passage is familiar. God kneels. The all-powerful one kneels. The Creator kneels and washes. Severin of Gabala, writing in AD 400, he put it poetically this way. He who wraps the heavens in clouds wrapped round himself a towel. He who pours the water into the rivers and pools dipped water into a basin. And he before whom every knee bends in heaven and on earth and under the earth knelt to wash the feet of his disciples. It's the God who kneels. But it isn't just this past act. God continues, if you will, to wash and wash. God washes now. I want you, and again, in your praying imagination, put yourself at the meal. There's an extra chair for you. There's an extra seat for you. You're there, and you're eating, and you're enjoying the conversation, and Jesus gets up, and he takes off his outer garment and wraps a towel around his waist, and he kneels before you, not someone else, but before you. How do you respond? Are we like Peter? No, God, not me, this double negative. No, never. Don't wash my feet. Because maybe we're resistant at the core of our heart, because for Jesus to wash our feet, we have to admit there's a problem. We have to admit we are cut up and we need mending. For Jesus to wash our feet, we have to admit we are dirty and we need to be cleaned. That we smell and we need healing. See, when grace moves from an abstract idea to a person in front of you dealing with your own issues, it can become traumatic. That's why Victor Hugo in his novel Les Mis put it this way. He said, grace is the greatest and most formidable assault. Grace is the greatest and most formidable assault. It assaults our ego. It assaults our pride. It assaults our sense of self-reliance. For Jesus to wash me, I have to admit I am not okay. And oftentimes, like, yes, our sin, yes, our brokenness, our shame and our guilt, those things separate us from God. But I wonder at a more deeper level, the thing that really pushes us away from God is our rejection of his grace. Our unwillingness to admit our need. We hold on to our ego and to our pride and to our self-reliance. My feet, they're a little dirty, but they're not bad. Not me, Jesus, surely someone else. Theologian Hermann Vitterbos, he put it this way. It is not sin as such. It is the repudiation of grace that makes a person a lost being. It is the rejection of grace. It is the repudiation of grace. It's admitting I am selfish with my time. I am greedy with my money. I am hurtful with my words. I am unclean with my thoughts. Jesus, I am cut up. I am dirty. I am smelly. I am unclean. Wash me. As Peter says, not just my feet, but my whole body. So friends, let me ask you, don't make it abstract. Don't leave it in history. In a way, bring that washing to today. Have you sensed the trauma of grace? Not in a bad way, but in a good way. Have you let the grace of Jesus assault your ego and your pride and your self-reliance? Have you felt the force of that? I am unclean, make me clean. I am cut up, heal me. Let the grace and mercy of Jesus assault your ego, because there is the place where healing is found. Let grace move from an abstract idea to something that you surrender to and receive. And then, friends, be confident in that. Once washed, always washed. Once forgiven, always forgiven. If you are washed by Christ, there's nothing more powerful than that. So rest in that and receive that. And let that be your confidence. And this is so important, because we can't get to the idea of Jesus setting an example for us. We can't get to the idea of us being a people of mercy and justice who seek the good of our neighbors. We can't arrive at that application until we walk through the map, if you will, of Jesus washing our feet. Because if we jump to that, that we're going to use our acts of kindness towards our neighbor and our acts of mercy and justice as a justification for Jesus to accept us. God, look at all that I've done for you. Now love me. Now receive me. Now give me a good life. As opposed to, I am received and loved and blessed by the kindness and mercy of Jesus. And because of that, I can now be a person who is freed up to wash others. Follow that map right. Jesus washed then, he washes now. Who are we washing? Verse 15. Jesus, after he gets up, goes back to the table. I have set an example that you should do as I have done for you. And what's interesting is that word example, it also could be pattern. And it makes me think of an outline, like a coloring book. It's like Jesus has traced the outline. He's given us the outline. My boys, they've got coloring books all over the house. And they love to grab crayons and markers and colored pencils and kind of fill in the outline. I think that's what Jesus is saying here. He isn't saying literally go and wash feet. He is saying, I have given you an example. I have given you a pattern. I've drawn an outline what it looks like for you to look to the interest of your neighbor, to love God and to love your neighbor, to be a person of mercy and to promote biblical justice. I have painted an outline for you, drawn an outline for you. Now be creative and be imaginative and fill it in. And use different colors. I've set an example for you. I mean, I see people in this community using their creativity. A handful of you have rallied around a foster mom to support her. Others of you are tutoring refugee children just a couple miles down the road. Some of you are forming a team to care for an Afghan refugee family. Some of you give your time once a month to hang out with toddlers on the other side of the building and love on them. Or mentor students entering into teenage years. And we could go on and on and on. I have set an example for you. I've set a pattern for you. I've drawn an outline for you. As I have washed, now you wash. And be creative. Maybe a little bit more practical. And before I talk about the act of following this example, let me start first with this idea of kneeling. You know, sometimes to activate the mind and to stir the heart, we need to get the body engaged. And I wonder if this act of Jesus kneeling and washing our feet isn't something helpful for us. Like, what if we daily committed to kneeling prayer? Or if kneeling is difficult for us, or if our life circumstances make that kind of undoable, maybe if it's just we daily commit to praying like this, with our hands open, that we engage our bodies with the thoughts of our minds. Maybe you pick the morning when you wake up, or it's midday at lunch, or before you go to bed. And what would it look like if you kneeled? We never kneel. What if you kneeled and you prayed? It doesn't have to be long, but what if that act of kneeling engages your mind and puts you back to that reminder, that assurance of God's grace in your life, that you have been washed by the blood of Christ. And that act of kneeling then can spur you on and encourage you and motivate you to be a person who then goes and kneels before others and washes their feet. What if you did that? What works for you morning, afternoon, evening? What if you knelt? What if you knelt and just prayed the Lord's Prayer once a day and engaged your body that way with your praying life? So there's a kneeling, but there's also, again, this idea that we're not just receptacles of mercy. We're meant to be people who are merciful. Atul Gawande, he was a late physician and author, and he tells a story in his book about a doctor who was working in a nursing home. And he convinces the administrator to bring in dogs and parakeets and hens and a bunch of animals for the patients to care for. That these patients were kind of aimless and these animals were brought in to give some vitality and life. And he records that the results were significant. Residents began coming to life. Those who weren't speaking started speaking. He said psychotropic drugs for agitation, the use dropped 38%, deaths dropped 15%. There was life, there was vitality in this nursing home because of these animals coming in and this work that was being done. And the architect of the changes said, all this happened because of the fundamental human need for a reason to live. Or as Gawande put it, we all seek a cause beyond ourselves. See, it isn't just that Jesus has washed your feet. It isn't just that we kneel and pray, though we rest in those two things. But those are to be springboards for us to have purpose in life. That we are to have mission and to love and to metaphorically kneel before others and wash their feet. And here's the thing, friends. I imagine as you are thinking in your mind, you know who you should love. You know that person that you should wash. You know that person that you should be gracious to. See, it isn't about, finding the lovable person. The job isn't to go find a person who is lovable, but rather to love the person that is right in front of you. And Jesus has brought co-workers into your life. He's brought parents into your life. He has brought children into your life. He has brought church members into your life. He has brought neighbors on your block into your life. And I wonder if those are the people that God is asking you to follow his example and care for them and love on them and get low and wash their feet. See, it isn't about finding somebody who is lovable. It's loving the person right in front of you. That coworker, that neighbor, that parent, that child. If we follow Jesus, he gives us crayons. And he says, be creative and draw and love. One final thought before we come to the table. It's interesting when you think about the early church and the way that their minds must have just been exploding as the identity of Jesus was being unveiled more and more and more to them, where they moved from Jesus being this wise and thoughtful rabbi to their imagination growing to them, realizing this is God in the flesh who knelt before us and washed us. And it led Christians to live a different way. Actually, the early church was called a third people, or a third way. See, the first way was the Roman way. The Roman way is where you just capitulate to the dominant culture. You're just immersed into the dominant culture, and there's no distinctiveness that you have. And Rome would do that over and over. They would go into different cities and different peoples, and they would take them over, and the people would just be assimilated into the Roman culture. That was the first way. And the second way was the Jewish way. It was isolation. It was separation. It was being set apart and distinct and not a part of the culture, but being different from the culture and over here, isolated. But because of the Jesus way, these Christians, they introduced a third way that the Romans and the Jewish, they didn't know what to do with. Because these Christians were a part of the culture and yet they weren't assimilated into the culture. They were immersed into the culture, but there was a difference about them. In fact, there's a Roman official, his name is Diogenes. And there was a letter written to him because he was so curious about these new people, these third people, this third way. And so he wanted to find out more. And this is what this so-called letter to him we have from the second century describes Christians this way. He learned this. Christians are not distinct from other people by nationality and language or customs. They do not inhabit separate cities of their own, or speak a strange dialect, or follow some strange way of life. Yet there is something extraordinary about their lives. See what he's saying? They're part of the city. They're part of the commerce. They're part of the everyday, ordinary life in the city. They're immersed. But it's not the first way. They don't isolate themselves. There's something extraordinary about them. And what is the extraordinary thing? See, humanity creates gods out of our ego and our pride. We take whatever is good and right about humanity, and we blow that up, and we make that our gods. In the times of old, they would take the wisdom of Socrates, only more, and make that a god. You take the power of Hercules, only more, and make that a god. You take the military prowess of Alexander the Great, only more, and make that a god. Over and over again, humanity would fashion God in our own image and take the best of what we are as humans, only more, and make that a god. And these Christians, though, they were a third way because they didn't make God in their image. God was unveiled to them. He was unveiled. He was unveiled as Jesus Christ, who took out his outer garment and put a towel around his waist and poured water and washed feet and dried. It was unveiled to them that the God of the universe is a God who kneels. And that God then says, go and follow my example. And because of that unveiling, they lived radically different lives. They, as individuals, this collective, created this third way that transformed the world. And it's fascinating. The Apostle Paul's letter to the church in Philippi, Philippians 2, 7, and 8, you could overlay it with our passage, and it explodes what's happening here, the greater implications of Jesus kneeling. Paul will write to the Philippians and say, he being Jesus, he made himself nothing. By taking the very nature of a servant and being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, God humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. And that is why the letter then to Diognetus went on like this, talking about Christians. Because of the God that was unveiled to them, because of the God they followed, this is what he found out. These Christians are like other people. They marry and have children, but they do not cast them out. And they share their meals, but they do not share their beds. And they are obedient to the laws, and yet they live on a level that transcends the law. Christians love all men, but all men persecute him. To speak in general terms, we may say, and let this be true of us, that the Christian is to the world what the soul is to the body. See, because we don't make a God in our image, but God has been unveiled to us. As we have been washed by him, let us be a people of mercy toward our neighbors. Not taken over by the culture and not isolating ourselves by the culture, but living in the culture with this distinctive, that we are a people who walk around with a towel in our hands. We walk around with a towel in our hands, looking for who we can wash, because God first washed us. And that washing, which happened earlier in Jesus' life, led to the table and ultimately to the cross. See, it was on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he gave thanks and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, this is my body, which is for you. Eat this in remembrance of me. And after the supper, he took the cup of the new covenant in his blood shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this in remembrance of me. And whenever we eat from the bread and we drink from the cup, we proclaim Jesus' death. We proclaim that God was unveiled to us. We proclaim that we worship a God who goes so low to make us clean that he kneels and he washes what is dirty and cut up and unclean. And he mends it and makes it whole with the aroma of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for the bread. Thank you for the cup. God on bended knee. God, body broken, blood shed. And I pray that we just would rest in the awesome reality of that. That Jesus, just like you set aside your outer garment, you set aside the glory of heaven. And you went low and took on your shoulders, our weakness and our burdens and our temptations. The places that we are cut up and broken, or we smell, and you pour us on us your aroma, and you make us your own. I pray that we would rest in the comfort of that. But not only resting in it, Lord, would you make us a people who follow this example, who walk around with a towel in our hands, looking who we can love in the name of Christ. And Lord, we pray now as you taught your people to pray, praying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the glory and the power now and forever. Amen. Amen. Well, it's our practice here at Covenant that to take communion, we rise from our seats, we come to the middle aisle, go to the section closest to you, take the bread and take a cup. The red one is wine, the white one is juice. Choose your own adventure. It's your choice, okay? Let's rise now, come forward.
Let's stand together as we complete our worship service this morning. We're going to sing a song that was new to us last week, but I really love the image of kneeling before God, because in kneeling, it's coming basically with empty hands to him to receive his mercy and his goodness, and this song is all about Jesus as our good and gracious King.
approach the throne of glory. Nothing in my hands I bring, but the promise of acceptance from a good and gracious King. I will give to you my burden.
Gracias.
You're a good and gracious King.
Amen. Amen. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face to you and give you peace today. Amen.